This is From Hero to Zero, a show about the misconception of the demise of the music industry. We talk to heroes to make sense of the alleged zero, the music business.
Hi Munky, how are you?
I'm good, I'm a little jet lagged, but...
A little jet lagged?
Oh, well. I'm good, I'm happy to be here.
Very good, we're happy to have you here and looking forward to your show later on tonight.
Thank you.
Great. So, Munky, you've been in the music business and playing with Korn, for Korn, for decades now. Where do you see the main differences about being an artist, a musician, today, 2017, compared to when you started, late 80s, early 90s?
I think a lot of the musicians, for me, from my perspective, I think you definitely have to be smarter in the sense that all around you have to have, you can write songs, but you have to know how to market and the whole other side to things that I see that a lot of the record label stuff, they did before. Record labels and that responsibility that they carried the artist so much before, and now it's really up to the artist to make sure they're dotting their I's and crossing their T's on every sort of aspect of their band, whether that's from like their merchandising and the designs to touring and the logistics and getting in front of as many fans as possible. You have to be smarter, you have to be clever. Before, there was a kind of more like in the late 80s and early 90s, where it was just kind of like, you gotta be a little bit street smart, you know? Make sure you pay rent at the rehearsal studio, and make sure your stuff doesn't get locked up in, you know, or hell because you didn't pay rent. You know, kind of hustling to get a gig or whatever. That was a little bit more difference, I think.
How did you learn to become smarter in business terms? How did you go about that?
A lot of failures.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, you learn that the hard way. And, you know, it's still a learning process. It's still... You kind of try to juggle being an artist and still trying to have that side, the two-side way of thinking. And you know, a lot of artists don't want to mess with that stuff. It's not the best thing for creativity. But you know, if you can kind of compartmentalize each thing and deal with it a little at a time, it's a lot easier to kind of discover.
Sure. One of the main issues that we have nowadays, or that happened somewhere around the turn of the century, was the technological advancements. They made it harder for new artists to, especially to, let's say, earn money, right? Revenue stream kind of started decreasing. Did you realize that when it started happening, when the internet started getting the industry to implode?
It was sort of like, let's use this and utilize this as a tool for people to reach people around the world. It was a way to fast track exposure and get people interested in what you were doing. And I remember utilizing the technology on Life is Peachy. We did a live internet stream, which was the first time ever a band had done anything like that from the studio at Indigo Ranch, which was where we recorded our first two albums with Ross Robinson, and he did many other bands. People aren't familiar with his work, but we sort of embraced that technology from the beginning, and so I think we were in that generation that was a little bit ahead of that curve. But as far as generating revenue from, I don't think anybody really saw that. I think they may have saw it coming, but nobody really came up with a formula or a sort of to decipher how this is gonna you know, translate later. And you just had to be smart. You just had to kind of, but even the bottom fell out of, you know, record sales. And but the good news is, like at Night Tonight, you have a lot of people buying tickets because I think because music is free now, basically. You know, you can buy your subscription on your streaming services. And still, it's still, you know, hundreds of a penny that you get for one stream. But people are spending more money than ever on ticket sales and seeing live shows and concerts. So there's always a trade-off, you know. I don't think anybody saw that coming, you know, either. So concert performers.
So you feel actually that, because that was an idea, right, from the business, that the business model is changing, so they want to have more people coming to shows because those tickets are more expensive than buying music. So do you feel it, or have you been feeling it over the past few years?
Yeah, we've been seeing that.
Okay, perfect. Talking about live experiences, since now so many more people go to live shows, it seems as if there is a trend towards having to have more perfection in your shows. In live music, that means having maybe backing tracks. In the studio, that means maybe having more digital manipulation in the music. What is your opinion on that?
I think it still has to be organic. It still has to come from a real place. And, you know, I think as genuine as you can be, still being professional and in the production side of things is, you want people to come back at the end, you know, at the end of the show, you want people to go, wow, that was an amazing experience. I can't wait to see them again. And maybe look at their tour schedule and be like, where are they going now? That interest is created because, you know, that excitement that you give a crowd is, it's something that you want to leave a music fan with, I think every artist. But also you have to come from an organic place. It can't look too rehearsed, you know. It has to, you know, maybe not every song for us. There's a couple of songs, newer songs, that are on, we have a few backing tracks. But I'd say 80-90% of our set list is all just organic, you know, the band, you know, that's the way it should be. Few samples, a few, you know, keyboard parts here and there, just to kind of, basically we're trying to get as close as we can to the recorded versions without making it sound, it's live music, so it, when I go see a band, I like to see the inconsistencies in them. I like when someone makes a mistake on stage. I don't want to see the perfect, it's too robotic, it's too, you know, not too many mistakes, you know, but it's always, it makes the show, you know, there's a connection between human to human instead of just hitting play on a computer. It's just me.
I like that, and I agree with you. First of all, from pretty much in the beginning, you already had something, I think it was called Korn cages on stage.
Yeah. So it was something we did with the fans to sort of get them involved in, you know, the production of the show, and it was a fun experience, I think, for most people, because once they get up there, you can't use the bathroom.
I understand, of course. But I need to ask in this regard. So you always try to include fans, also with the live stream you just mentioned, which was I think 1998 around that.
I think. 97. Yeah,
even
close.
So very, when you didn't have social media and web tool and stuff.
It was like dial-up modems.
Exactly. So you tried to always engage fans. Nowadays, when you play live, you have a direct gratification because you see what people are like, yeah, I love your music. Albums, you mentioned album sales are different than before. Where's the gratification? What is the gratification from selling, for instance, your brand new album, Serenity of Suffering? How do you get gratification from that? Where do you see it?
I mean, we do. We see it live. We see it when we play the songs. Also in the meet and greets that we do. You know, we do VIP meet and greets too. A lot of fans bring newer album artwork or the CD or limited edition piece of vinyl or something, which is nice to see that returning, you know. So that's sort of like, that gives you an instant.
Okay.
An instant like, yeah, cool, this is, seeing people enjoy that kind of thing is nice.
What about charts nowadays? I mean, your band was always in the charts, or it still is to this day. How important are charts positions nowadays compared to back then?
You know, unfortunately, like the industry, still everybody looks at the statistics and the data, and then they judge how well your band is. I judge it by going out there and seeing how the faces and people fucking losing their shit. You know, that's how I judge it. That's, you know, and you think of bands like, which I have so much respect for because they've done it, they've written their own, they've made their own, cut their own path, is a band like Tool. They have removed themselves from that sort of standard, you know, the industry standard, and I just admire that so much. You know, they've kind of just forged their own path. They don't care about that. They make records as they please, and they can go out and sell out, you know, giant arenas every night if they want. But that's the whole thing about it. There's a special thing about it that they've created, and it's really cool that they can do that. Everybody, you know, it takes a certain consistency and a lot of saying no, you know, and I admire that.
Definitely. Last question, going back to the technology argument or issue, nowadays we have social media, many-to-many communications platform with lots of trolls. You have lots of followers on several different platforms. How do you go about not reading trolling comments, or do you actually do read them? Do you reply to them? How do you go about it? How do you live with that? It can be quite a depressing sometimes.
Yeah, the only time I will read through some comments is, you know, if there's an announcement, like the tour announcement that we just made in a few days ago about us going on a tour, the North American tour. I want to see what people think and how they're excited. But like if it's just a family photo or me, I don't care. But you know, I'm curious to see what people are saying when it's directly band related. You know, if it, like today I put on my social media, I put an old photo of me and Head and Jonathan, and it was just an old cool photo of us, black and white. I like it. I don't care what anybody says about it. I like it. It's cool. But like the new music or a video, I can't help myself. I'll go through it and read it. And there's people that don't like it. That's okay. I'm not trying to make everybody happy. I'm just trying to make most Korn fans happy. You know.
Beautifully said.
Yeah.
Great. Well, Munky, it was very interesting. Thank you so much.
Thanks
and all the best with the tour.
Cool. Thanks a lot.